for a couple of years now. It was commissioned in 2014 as a look to the future of our field, looking at trends and themes. And out of this report, and then a lot of folks who participated in the research to put together the Anchor Blue Ribbon report. And it's really interesting, the trends and the themes, and now the recommendations that have come out of that. And Corky has been absolutely instrumental in putting together the Anchor Blue Ribbon report, and we want to continue with the follow-up and the Anchor board paying close attention to what's coming out of this report. And there'll be an opportunity later today for some more participation from all of you to sort of shape the future of Anchor. Corky is also, as you saw last night, if you're here for the Leadership Award ceremony, he is a recipient of the Anchor Nature Center Leadership Award. Corky has 30 plus years experience in the field as director at Treehaven Field Campus in Wisconsin. He also hosted an Anchor Summit and a professor at University of Wisconsin Stevens Point. And now Corky, with all of his years of his experience, is working as a consultant and as a sponsor of the summit as well through his new business, Lead Team Consulting. So I'd like to bring up Corky.
I know stories of most of you in here, but that's not allowed here. Next time. Well, I remember the first time that I took a walk out of the woods with a group of kids. They were fourth graders. This was back a long time ago, in the 70s. And we were on a brand new boardwalk, walking through the swamp, and came across a beautiful cinnamon tree. So I started talking about the cinnamon tree to the fourth graders. And a little girl raised her hand. She says, "I know what that is." I go, "Really?" I said, "What? Tell me." She says, "Well, my mom and dad, they grow these things." I go, "Really?" I said, "Well, do they sell them?" "Oh, no, they smoke them." The 70s were fun. So it kind of reminds me to take a step back as we approach the research that's been done in the future of our profession, to take a look at perhaps why this coming upon which was a fairly simple model of what we were and what our overall mission statement was for our organizations. We have a nature center, and then down here to the right hand was our constituency. And we built this place, and we said, "Here we are. Come and see us." And we didn't really have strong connections, but over time, we kept moving forward and realizing that we had to make stronger connections to our community. And so we started connecting with a variety of audiences. And perhaps our mission overall, conceptually, began to change and begin to mature, if not evolve. Well, then we started looking at things that were even more complicated. We started looking at impact of what we're doing. We're trying to figure out how to remain relevant in our communities and build capacity for engaging people in our environment. So this is a little bit of a background to lead us into is this the direction that collectively we all feel that we may be heading into if we haven't already done so. And so let's see. Take a look at some of the background that has been done in our profession or related professions, like the field of environmental education or residential outdoor education. So we want to take a look at that, and this helped guide the research that was done for the Blue Ribbon Report. And I have, by the way, a few handouts up here on the resources that you'll be seeing on the screens here. So if anybody's interested in diving further into the literature, you have that up here. To increase the impact, there are two main things that the research has indicated. so far. And this is not necessarily exhaustive research in the area, but we probably know these things, or at least we feel these things are right, but longer experiences are better than shorter experiences. So a one-hour program is not probably going to have the impact that an all-day program might have. An all-day program might not have the impact that a residential program might have over time. Multiple experiences are also important. So it's not just a six-hour day with a group of kids in the fall, but to have impact with those students over time, we may need to bring them back. If you're a day program, bring them back in fall, winter, and spring, or have multiple longer experiences. So what research in the literature there is has indicated those are two important things to consider in business. Keep that in the back of your mind because of the what that means to us in our profession, as we also try to find the funding to keep our organization sustainable. And then there's some literature out there that talks about how do we really change environmental behaviors. Because those of us that are involved in environmental education directly have always been looking at the Tillis Declaration from the 70s, which talked about, you know, from awareness to changing behavior, environmental action, and so forth. There are some key things that the literature, if you look at all that literature out there, there's not a lot, but it looks at the environmental behavior and says we have to have active participation to be able to make a change with behavior. We can't just do it in the classroom. Can't just do it in a lab. We have to have the students engaged. And that's probably one of the strengths that all of our organizations have. That's where we're coming from. I mean, we don't usually have kids come out to our nature centers and sit in the classroom all the whole time. What would be the point of that, right? So active participation is important. Just as important is to remove the barriers to that active participation. And that includes everything from how do we remove the barriers to underserved populations, to populations that have special challenges, populations that may be far away from the nature center? How do we remove those barriers? And then the final one is interesting because residential centers and outdoor facilities have a pretty strong hold on this one. But it's also to change environmental behavior, to get students and people to change their environmental behaviors. We need to help increase their individual competencies. And that's defined in the literature as two different ways. One, it's not just knowledge. It's not just about what is out there, but it's their competencies in themselves, their confidence in themselves to be able to make a difference. And so think about the programs that you do that maybe help do that, to help build the confidence and the competencies in the individuals. But it's not just individuals. To change environmental behavior, the literature seems to be saying that we also need to help that group of people be able to collectively work together, to learn collaboration, to learn that a group of people working together effectively can make change. And so we have a bigger responsibility if we're to meet those lofty goals and mission statements that we have, all of us have. I mean, if you don't know your mission statement, go look at it real quick sometime today and see how big and lofty that really is. And these are some of the things in the literature that are speaking to us in that way. So we continue. Last summer in Georgia, we heard Stern and folks that are associated with the study that talked about our own relevance. And so you've heard me use the terms impact, and you've heard me use the term relevancy, or being relevant. And we'll discuss those, and hopefully continue the discussion this afternoon about are those the same, or could they be different. But Stern reported that to be relevant, and this was specific to nature centers, was that we needed to support environmental connections. We need to be able to help the individuals that experience our programs directly connect that experience to their whole environment. And it can't be just viewed as an isolated event. We need to make those connections. We need to help engage those folks toward environmental concerns. And then next, we need to make sure that we have a place for leisure. The very first ANCA consult that was held at Tree Haven in 1985. It was a whole board thing. There's a whole bunch of stories there about it. Talk to me. One of the things that group helped me realize at Tree Haven, that we were doing snowshoeing, we had snowshoe trails, we had cross-country ski trails, we were doing map and compass, Pokemon. And we were doing all these wonderful things, but recreation, passive recreation, leisure, getting people out wasn't even a part of our mission statement. And that group of Hanky Board back then made us realize that that was an important part of what we were doing. Well, Stern's research shows that that's what people are looking for in our facilities to help us remain relevant to them. And so that's an important part to consider. And then to strengthen communities' resilience. Now, that's an interesting one. But I think what that really means, as I interpret, is that we need to be an integral part of our community. So whatever befalls the community, we need to be there to help support them. Was an economic downturn, how do we be a part of that? How do we help that? I know it's going to affect us as well, but how can we help our own communities be resilient to the changes that occur in our society? Interesting. And then another one was to promote civic engagement. This means helping people, following up to the one on environmental behaviors, helping them to be active, helping them to be engaged, helping them to have the competency and the skills to get involved. And perhaps it's not even just environmental things, but maybe it's social injustice, environmental justice. There's all kinds of things that can help us make that direct connection. So, because of the nature of who we are, our community can look to us to help them do that. And so the question is, are we engaged with it? So all of this literature led up to a 25th anniversary goal of ANCA to take a look at where we are viewed from the profession from here, from where we go next. So we use that as a background. We also used the original Blue Ribbon Report, which was 1989, sponsored by the Natural Science Youth Foundation. And Dick Tuttle, by the way, wasn't mentioned, but you were the leader of that organization for many years. And it was a great organization. It was sort of the previous predecessor to ANCA. And that report came out, and he said, well, let's look at it again. And so one of the greatest privileges I had in my position advising some graduate students, and so Andrew Revelle was my graduate student for this project. And Andrew is gainfully employed now in Utah at the Nature Center of Maryland, so we're really excited about that. He was the graduate student involved. I was the co-conspirator, I mean, advisor to the process, and we sent out a survey first to all the members. You may remember receiving that, or you may not, but we had about a 30% response rate. And the important kind of fun thing here is that we didn't sample the population, we looked at the entire population. So some of this information is generalizable to ANCA, which is really kind of fun. So we did a survey, collected all kinds of information, which we'll look at in a minute, and then we said, well, okay, these are interesting results, and here's some questions that we might want to ask in interviews. So we took the respondents, we divided them up into pools based on the demographic information we were asking, and we had those with 15 years or more of experience that we affectionately called seasoned leaders. There were other leaders. And then emerging leaders, we randomly selected some folks out of the leadership pools to be able to continue in-depth interviews. And so Andrew did a bunch and I did a bunch as well. So that began hi, I didn't know your picture was up there. And there wasn't.
There's an arrow up there, but you can't see it, Doctor.
It's pointing to the man in the heavy sunglasses. So let's take a look at what are some of the changes that you all just thought maybe was coming to our profession. So from the survey, 96% said that we are going to be raising funds from new sources in the future. What that meant when we looked at the comments and results of some of the interviews and so forth, that meant two things. That we had become much more entrepreneurial in the work that we're doing. We're not going to be able to raise funds perhaps from the continued long-standing sources that we have. Grants may not be as available, but we have to continue to increase our revenues. So the audience was saying, the respondents were saying to us, we have to be better entrepreneurs, and we also have to focus more on the legacy of what we're doing. And legacy in this case meant endowments and long-term, not any short-term, but long-term investments into the funding sources that we're looking at. So changes in perhaps how we're, almost everybody thought we were going to be doing that. The executive role, director's role is definitely going to change, and we've seen that happen already. Many of you here, well maybe not many, but some of you here that are relatively new directors in the last 5 years may not have come from the education field or from the naturalist field or the biologist field. But maybe you've already had nonprofit experience, or maybe you've switched from the corporate world to the nonprofit world. And so our folks in the future are going to need more business background, more business skills, and the kinds of acumen that we need to be able to integrate into the community as a business in that community, not just one of those things out there and part of our community. Better at fundraising and much more involved externally from the ecosystem. So what that means, program directors or non-directors that are here, what that means in the future, you may even see less of the executive director at your facility. Because for the facility to be successful, they're going to be external, out into the community, out there where the resources are, the connections are. As executive directors that are 5 years or less here, or fairly new in your position, and you have a smaller organization, you're finding yourself being drawn internal, you're really working hard to keep things going on a daily basis. The research is indicating, and not only this research, but other research is indicating that we really have to refocus outward as the executive director. So our roles are changing. Our center's role in the community is changing. We've already seen from the Stern report that we're going to be relevant in the community. We're going to have to be engaged with that community and helping them to be civically engaged. And so yourself said that we need to be an active voice for our environment, that we're going to have to help the community engage and be successful in environmental causes. From my early on in my career, it was all about education. And that's what we were. That's what we did. We taught about nature. And the trend in our future is going to probably change to be relevant to the community. And throughout this entire research, we never asked the word relevant, but that's what was coming out of this, both in the surveys, the interviews. It all boils down to one word, relevant. Our relationship with schools. At first I thought we would see from the survey that our school programs were going to decrease, because we've talked a lot about that. And many of us have maybe done that, but that didn't come out of the survey. But what did come out of the survey was that we were looking for more authentic experiences in the future for the students that are coming out. So it's not just a field trip that we're going It's maybe collecting insects that are part of a research project that's going on at a local university and being a part of that. Many of you are involved in citizen science, something like that. Active engagement, participation, things that are real to those audiences that they're serving. So when they go back to their communities, they can apply that directly to where they live. I know there's some great case studies out here in this audience of people being able to do that. Targeted audiences. So there was 57% of the folks said, you know, we're probably not going to be doing this in school groups in the future, and we're really looking at increasing our adult programming and family programming because the schools are just at a challenge financially and so on. There was some correlations put here to the data from the quantitative survey, which are interesting, and as Andy worked on this, so there's a correlation between increasing the need for fundraising and increasing staff. Well, okay, that makes sense. We can't do it alone anymore. We need more professional staff that are going to be involved in fundraising and legacy work and other types of things to help us achieve fiscal sustainability. But it also says that increasing educational staff is going to equal increasing fundraising and public relations staff. So hold that thought. Increasing public relations staff equals fundraising staff. So what does that mean? What do those three things together mean? It means that our education staff are going to be integral in fundraising and public relations. That we're going to start to be able to grow our positions. We're going to be not maybe adding more and more staff, but we're going to be adding skill sets. We need to add responsibilities. And again, our education staff are going to probably be involved in fundraising. And it's a part of their job description. It's all going to change to move toward that. Will we have, and I remember early in my career, staff that they were the educator, they had no notice to be involved in that kind of work. But perhaps for us to be relevant in our communities and to be fiscally sustainable, we might have to do that. The other correlation was between the recession that we were just coming out of when this research was conducted, but the impact of all of that is making us rethink our future, rethinking our, we have to be more attentive to our strategic direction, a little bit more attentive to our resources, so that we can't predict the next one, but we need to be better prepared for the next one. So there was a correlation with that in terms of staffing and funding. So then we looked at some comparisons. We did ask and organize the data from the survey between emerging leaders and seasoned leaders. And you know seasoned leaders that are in the audience here, I love you very much. Emerging leaders are likely to be more technology oriented, more likely to include technology into programming and so forth. And that's probably pretty obvious because I can see some of my seasoned friends here looking down at their phone. Are they texting? Not likely. They're trying to figure out how to turn it on. I did say I loved you. Emerging leaders are more likely to incorporate climate change into the curriculum than seasoned leaders. And thank goodness for that. And I think climate change came out specifically because it is the hot issue right now. And it's important. And we need to figure out the best ways to be able to do that. Emerging leaders are more likely to tackle that than the seasoned leaders. Emerging leaders are more likely to collaborate with other nonprofit organizations. was more specific than that. They said they were more likely to collaborate with other nature centers. So thank goodness. I think we've done a tremendous job in this profession, connecting us as professionals. But the new emerging leaders are saying, well, how do we really collaborate with each other as institutions? And so that's exciting to hear. Emerging leaders are more likely to expand programming beyond schools, and emerging leaders are more likely to connect authentic experiences with the programming that they do, incorporated within experiences. And as individuals, emerging leaders are more likely to be directly involved in volunteer efforts in their local communities for environmental causes. So all that came out of the surveys. Then we looked at a lot of the detailed, in-depth questions that we wanted to figure out what did this all mean to be relevant in our communities. And so these came out, the surveys and the interviews all collected and all put together. So to bring this down into a summary is that our leaders that nature centers, not just us as individuals, but our institutions, will become leaders in conservation and restoration. And many of you, there's some great examples out there of folks that have done that. And it is beyond education. It is the conservation and restoration of our own sites, the conservation and restoration of environmental action in our communities. And so we'll be leaders in that. So organization, our communities might not just be looking to our centers as a place of nature, a place of beauty, a place that can come out and walk leisurely on the trails. But they might really be looking at us to say, okay, you were an education center in the past, now you're a part of this community, help us be engaged in stewardship in our communities. We'll be leaders in education and advocacy. So education was beyond just, you know, doing good things, but it's actually developing models of best practices in education and being leaders in our community in education, not followers in our community with education, but becoming leaders of education and leaders in advocacy in our community. So again, civic engagement, environmental causes, and so forth. So, there could be a fundamental change in how we view ourselves. If we listen to ourselves and what we think might happen. Leaders in collaborations and partnerships. So not just waiting for somebody to call us up and say, hey, how would you like to be a part of this? But we look at the community, we discover what's needed in the community, and we be leaders in establishing those collaborations and partnerships. We've had good discussions about partnerships in the past year, Anika, and one of the things that we've talked a lot about is that sometimes we pull partnerships together because we need something. And instead, a true partnership, as talked about in the research and in the literature, is that when we see a need in the community at a higher level, and we want to be able to go with this group over here because the two of us together can make a difference at this higher level that neither one of us can do by ourselves. And so that's being a leader in collaborations and partnerships. We need to be leaders in reflecting our community, which I know is a struggle we talk about. If we're in an urban area and we're serving a fair amount of underserved populations, and we don't have anybody in our board or committees or involved directly representing those communities, that's a challenge. It's an issue. And we want to be leaders in that. We want to be a model for other nonprofit organizations in the community and how to do that. So we're looking out into the future with these things. And these are all part of the recommendations that are in Anka, or in Anka's home now. And both, by the way, Stern's report and Andrew's report is available through the Anka website. So is this what we look like? And we have that one little green circle and a little box off the side. Is this our future model of what we look like? And it all boils down to, we're going to be relevant in our communities. Maybe it's a little bit more complex than a placeholder here and a place with a sign that says, welcome. It's much more than that. So this leads us into this afternoon's discussion. The overriding question is, I think we've all viewed ourselves as relevant. When did we know we were relevant? I mean, the first nature centers in this country, yes, they're relevant. But are we relevant to the community today? We think we're relevant. We think we're important. But there's the community. And so this afternoon, we're going to have an opportunity to take a look. Based on the recommendations and the report, we're going to be able to take a look at six questions. So I think it's at 3 o'clock when the session is. 3:50. We're back in this room together. And if you're new to Anchor, one of the unique things you probably already experienced, but will experience this afternoon, is that we get together, we think, and we talk, and we figure things out, and we make record, and we pass these things on to the board and say, board, help us do these things. And so we call that trends. We call those trend sessions. We do them every other year or so. It's a tradition in this organization. And so when we come back this afternoon, we're going to take a look at six different questions. And I'll be back out here just to introduce it. The board members are going to help facilitate some long-term sessions all around this room. And we'll be able to look at these questions. How do we be relevant in our community? How do we become leaders in conservation and advocacy beyond our traditional education roles? How do we build for resiliency when that next recession or something comes? What programs will achieve impact? What programs will the community view as relevant? And then how does our leadership reflect on the community? So you'll be able to choose which one of those questions you want to gather around some good head thinking with other colleagues. And this information will be collected and come back to the board. Well, think about that first experience that you've had and think about the differences that are happening. Thanks, Kathy, for the photographs and triple audacious center for all of this, except the last 10 minutes. And think about how we are going to move our entire profession forward to be not perhaps just relevant in our communities, but to be significant contributors to resiliency and having great impact within our communities. So we'll see you this afternoon.